Here we are, back with some more 7900 XTX testing in Star Citizen. And this is a very interesting one because, well, you may have seen the whole big temperature hoo-ha that's going around the internet at the moment. It seems as though with the reference versions of these cards, AMD, their design just doesn't really work in terms of cooling. So there's some big temperature deltas between difference between the average temperature on the GPU and the hotspot. And we'll get into that and I'll show you how that's affecting these cards. And we're also going to do some SAM testing, smart access memory. We're going to turn it off because it was on in the default testing. And then we've got some just turning the power slider up, overclocking, undervolting, the stuff that's in the AMD software. And then I've done a manual overclock as well to show you. But spoiler alert, some big issues with these cards in terms of power draw and temperature. As always, this testing has been done at Lawville. I've done my many, many runs for all these different setups. The first thing I wanted to compare was SAM, Smart Access Memory. With the initial testing that I did at 4K in the live patch 317.4, we got a baseline result. But when you turn SAM off, what do you have? Really no difference. If anything, performance is slightly better on the 1% lows, although you wouldn't notice that difference. But this kind of tracks with what I found when I did this sort of testing with the 3080. I found that really it didn't make any difference when you kind of hacked it into that card. In Star Citizen, it doesn't seem to make much difference, although other people have said that it has made a difference for them. So maybe it's just my combination of parts. Let's have a look at the max power slider next. You'll see the results here are not ideal. It doesn't really improve anything, maybe the 1% lows, and I'll show you why. If we turn up the slider, hit apply, you will see the board power go to 400 watts. You'll see the junction temperature shoot right up, throttles at 110, and you'll start to hear the fans get louder and louder. I'm shouting just to make sure you can hear me, but those fans are very, very fast, maximum basically, running at 100%. Not good for gaming in any way, in my opinion. And I think from what the research on the internet is suggesting, it looks like a vapor chamber problem with these reference model cards. If you then drop back to default settings, you'll get lower, but still the delta between these two, it takes a long time for the junction temperature to come down. It just doesn't seem to be able to effectively cool the whole of the GPU for whatever reason. Next up, we do a default undervolt. You click on this button here, it just does it in an undervolt, hardly anything really over here, but it doesn't seem to massively affect performance. So if you had one of these cards and you had to keep it, which we'll come on to in a minute, whether I'm going to keep this or not, you do have options, and you can actually probably get a lot more of an undervolt out of it. This is just kind of AMD's, they run some sort of test and give you a safe undervolt, but I think you probably could squeeze more out of it, as I'll show you when I do a bit of custom tuning at the end. Now, I'm showing you this all back to back just to kind of highlight the issue. Even when we're undervolted, because we did that kind of power slider thing where we got the temperatures right up, the card just can't get it down. It can't get the junction temperature down. So now when I click on the overclock GPU, the next testing I did, it does this little thing here. I don't know if you'll be able to see that, but it does a test. Oh yeah, you should be able to see that. It does a test, works out what it thinks an overclock is, and then runs with it. But again, you'll see, you might be able to hear the fans are ramping right up, and the temperatures are going up again. The overall GPU temperature, or the average, or whatever that's measuring, is still quite low, but the junction temperature is again really not under control. And for some reason, the total board power, even without changing the power limit, has gone up. I guess that's part of the overclock, is that it does a bit of a board power increase. So again, that's not a great option. The results for that, you see the 1% lows have increased again, but again, we're effectively throttled. We're either power throttled, the clock speeds aren't particularly high, or we're temperature throttled. It's just not really very effective. So let's move on now to overclocking the VRAM. So if we click on that, proceed. Can you see that still? Has everything crashed? Yeah, you can see that. Okay, you'll see it then does an overclock for the VRAM, and in theory, that's dropped the total board power down again, and the junction temperature has dropped again because it's not as intensive, I guess, in terms of power to overclock the VRAM. This doesn't keep the overclock of the GPU, and you'll see temperatures dropping. But what the problem with this one is, and this was kind of highlighted, I think Jay's Two Cents did a video on this, he found that overclocking VRAM reduced performance, and I found the same thing. You'll see here performance has dropped overall, and the only real explanation I think for this is that in overclocking the VRAM, you're taking power away from the clock speed, and therefore you're reducing overall the performance, or whatever. I don't know what's going on exactly there, but it's not good. It doesn't work to do that. So the final thing now to talk about, and the one where I got the most performance, was actually to just do my own custom overclock. So you turn everything on and you adjust. So I think this, I did some research on the internet and found that if you pop VRAM to 2700, if you actually found that dropping the maximum frequency on the GPU clock can help. I got quite a big undervolt going on. It was stable in Louisville. I wouldn't necessarily say that was stable anywhere else. And then again, you whack the power tuner up, the power limit up, and apply. You'll hear it go crazy again. Clock speeds are already still high because it just can't get the junction temperature down. But again, you'll see the junction temperature is gonna just keep going up and up and up as this runs. And it's not really a viable long-term setup, but it did get the most performance. So let's get rid of this before my computer explodes. It's still going to take ages. Again, you can hear the fan speed still going absolutely crazy, but the junction temperature, whilst the game is going on, just will struggle to get low again, but massive delta still there. But the actual performance was good for this. So we've got about an 8% increase in performance. The 1% lows were better as well, and so this just isn't a viable overclock in any way, but you at least can overclock these, and with a better board partner with different cooling, I think there's probably some headroom in these cards, but in these reference models, absolutely not. So what to make of all of this? Well, this has been a bit of a disappointment to me. I was all ready and happy to go with AMD this generation. I just think, in theory, the performance and the pricing is better than Nvidia. It's still not great, but it is better than the 4080. But it seems as though AMD, with this open goal that they had, have somehow managed to score an own goal. They've managed to go down the other end of the pitch and pop it in their own net. And it seems as though this is a widespread problem, that all the reference models, and not all of them, but a lot of the reference models that people have got, are suffering from what seems to be this vapor chamber issue in terms of the cooling. The suspicion at this point is that it is to do with the amount of liquid or water that's in the vapor chambers, maybe not enough. Who knows? AMD have yet to come out and really confirm what's going on, which is annoying, but I'm hoping for a refund, basically. Even though mine isn't one of the worst affected, some cards will just, at default settings, shoot straight up to 110 Celsius and stay there and start throttling straight away. Mine doesn't do that, but it just can't cool it properly. The delta can get really, really massive. And even actually when you're not messing around, even on default settings, it will rise and rise and rise as it goes on. And it's not really acceptable. The noise and everything about it is substandard and not acceptable for £1,000 graphics card, or more than that. So I'm in a weird spot where I think this is a great card, and performance-wise, I stand by the original review. At 4K, it is a monster, and it's great, but you definitely want to avoid, at least initially, these reference cards, because there's just an issue with them. And who knows what's going to happen? Are AMD going to just recall them, or the companies are going to have to just pull them back in, whack another cooler on them, and send them out again? I don't know, but I'm going to see what I can do, because there is an opportunity here. If it all works out, that I can get a refund for this one. And what I really wanted to do initially, which was never going to happen because of money, was to test this versus a 4080. And I do wonder now if I can get a refund, whether I just go and pick up a Founders Edition 4080, which seemed to be available in the UK, and then we can get the actual direct head-to-head. So wish me luck. That's what I'm aiming to do, I think, at this stage. I'm really gutted not to be able to stick with this card for this generation. I was thinking that would be what I would do, but I think it's now, if I can do it, it's too good an opportunity to miss if I can actually get a 4080. I think that would be the best thing, because then we can actually compare directly in Star Citizen. I can just run all the tests again. It seems as though 3.17.4 is going to be the live patch for still quite a while, so there should be enough time for me to run all the testing again, and we'll get an actual direct comparison, which would be amazing. So wish me luck on that one. If you like this sort of look at Star Citizen from a performance point of view, subscribe, like this video. Please become a member if you want to support financially with all these crazy hardware purchases I'm doing. And come and join the Discord, where there's loads of amazing people who can help with all sorts of things. So that's enough of this one. I'll see you soon. Bye.